Wow. Let's try it again. Ooh, now my microphone's on. Good morning, St. John's. There we go. There's a little Pentecost fire going. We gather this morning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. It is good to see you all this morning. Good to see you online as well. Here at St. John's, we are called and forgiven to love and serve. And so it is great to be together this morning. If you want to, go ahead, for those of you who are here, fill out your red books. But as well, you will notice in your red books, there's a new little section up here. See the name tags and the pens? Right now, every single one of you, you can see our lovely worship team has already done it. Put name tags on. And don't be giving me that look. We're going to be wearing name tags now for a while. And why? Because it's just good ministry. It's hospitality. It's hospitality to be able to share with one another what our names are. We expect the Holy Spirit to be bringing new people here. So we want everyone to know who each other is. And here's the other thing. When you guys come forward for communion, especially here in house, we want to call you by name. And Pastor Bruce doesn't know you all. So it's not about me. No, but we do want to. And also, we want, as more people come, as they're going to be welcoming a new pastor, we want to be able to know each other's names. So every Sunday, we're going to have name tags in here. We're going to ask you to put those on every single Sunday. And if you're like, wow, you know what? I don't want to waste that many trees. I don't like the sticky stuff. If you want one of the cool name tags, the magnetic ones that you've been seeing, you just call the office, contact us, and you can have your own magnetic name tag. So please go ahead, put those name tags on. We're going to be doing that every Sunday. Also, look at all of these geraniums. Thank you so much to all of you who donated the flowers. I think when I first started, we had like 2, and now we had over 40. So thank you so much. It's wonderful. And I have some prayers to add, some prayers that are not on our prayer sheet, so please add these people into your hearts. Tanya Heinemann, she called me this morning. She fell and dislocated her shoulder, and so she asked us to pray for her. So Tanya, I know you're with us online as well. We'll include you in our prayers. And Susan Clark, she was a former member here. She passed away this weekend out in Charleston. And so her memorial service will be at St. Matthew's in Charleston. So we pray for the family of Susan Clark. And Grace Getty is one of our high school seniors. Her grandmother had a stroke this weekend. And so we pray for Grace's family and for her grandmother as well. So please add all of those to your prayers. Again, I love seeing the name tags. Thank you very much. And it is good to be together on this Pentecost Sunday when the Holy Spirit sets us on fire. So please let us rise as we begin with our opening song.
Worthy is the Please join me in our call to worship. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Renew the face of the earth.
Come, Holy Spirit, come.
Renew our lives, inside and out. Renew our faith. Renew our relationships. Renew our trust in your mercy.
Challenges.
With fire and wind, come to this place. Gather us in. Send us out. Our hearts wider in love. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Renew the face of the earth. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Renew our lives inside and out. Triune God, we are the Easter people. We have witnessed the resurrection of our Lord and are now called to be people of the Pentecost. We are called to boldly share the good news of God's love. Open our hearts, Holy Spirit, to God's great power and love. Open our ears, minds, and souls to hear God's word for us and to joyfully proclaim Jesus Christ as our Savior. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share with one another the peace Christ brings us. Well, our scripture reading this morning is not from John 14, but rather is the account in Acts 2 of the day of Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost had come, the apostles were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages, as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one of them heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all of these who are speaking Galileans? How is it then that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, all in our own languages. We hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They're filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem. "Let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit. And they shall prophesy, and I will show portents in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." The word of the Lord.
Thank you, Pastor Bruce. I just like that he got to read all of those names. Like, I don't want to do that. Does anyone want to come forward for the children's sermon? Ever want to put anyone on the spot? You're more than welcome to come forward, or if you want to stay where you are, what do you think? I understand that. Okay, so that just turns the children's sermon into basically I just talk on the floor to everyone. So today, what color do we have a lot of? Red. And why do we wear red today? Pentecost. And red is the color of the Holy Spirit. Yes, thank you, Pastor Bruce. God, I love it when you have another pastor who knows the answers. So yes, so red is the color of the Holy Spirit. We have a triune God, right? We have a Trinitarian God. What are the three different ways that God relates to us? We have the Father, right? That's the Creator. We have the Son, that's Jesus. And then we have the Holy Spirit. Next weekend is Trinity Sunday, and guess who's up to preach? So he'll explain to you all about the Trinity, which is awesome. But today we're going to talk a little bit about the Spirit. Now, how many of you guys have, you feel like, oh, I have a firm grasp on what the Holy Spirit is? Anyone? Yep. So the Holy Spirit kind of eludes us. We don't always know what it is, how it all works. And I don't either, and I've been to seminary twice. But I have a couple of illustrations. So one, the Holy Spirit actually existed since the beginning in creation. When it says in Scripture that God breathed his breath on creation, that is the ruha. Can you say that? Ruha. And that is Hebrew for breath. And so the Holy Spirit is the breath of God. Say the word breath. See what it does to your mouth? Like, it's interesting that some words actually like go the way they sound, breath. And so the Holy Spirit is the breath of God. So a lot of people will say the Holy Spirit is wind, right? And so it blows. That's what we hear about in our passage today, kind of blowing the flames. And so sometimes I like to think about the Holy Spirit kind of like bubbles, right? And so what do you have to do in order to make bubbles? You have to blow, right? Right, so you have your breath, and then you get to be able to see the bubbles, right? They come out like that. Oops. Just be careful when you come up for communion, maybe a little slippery. But then the bubbles, what happens after they hang around for a while? They pop, right? And they kind of disappear, but yet they kind of don't, right? They're still there. They're still in the air or on the floor. So the bubbles, just like with the Holy Spirit, there are times when you can feel the breath and you can even see, look at them, still going. You can even see the Holy Spirit, right? There's times when you see the Holy Spirit in action in others. There's sometimes when you can even see it in your own self as you go to someone. There's someone pushing you, pulling you to do something. But then sometimes the Holy Spirit seems like it dissipates. It seems like it pops, but it actually never goes away. The Holy Spirit is one of those parts of God that is with us always in our lives. And so next week, spoiler alert, Pastor Bruce will be doing all about the Trinity and explaining the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit all together. But let us pray to thank God for the Spirit. Repeat after me. Repeat after me. Dear Jesus, we thank you for the Holy Spirit. Amen. Anyone like good documentaries? Anyone? Some good documentaries? I watched one this weekend on the comedian George Carlin. Anybody? Y'all laugh because he's pretty funny. I watched HBO Max has a two-part docuseries on George Carlin. Anyone see that one? Huh. Yeah, not a lot of people. So George Carlin, my father used to love his humor. And as I got older, I appreciated it even more. And I had no clue what a revolutionary he really was. And his journey of how he found his voice, his history, I know a little bit of his history with drugs, his marriage, the beautiful marriage and broken marriage he had. And he is actually a footnote in our American history when it comes to censorship, because of a court case that happened. But one of the parts of George Carlin's history is his journey with the church and faith. See, George Carlin, he actually grew up in an Irish Catholic family and even went to Catholic school, went to the grammar school. But in his comedy and in his life, he was very public that he did not believe in God, and he thought the whole thing was, well, BS. And to be candid, he had some very fair critiques of faith and God and the church and the world around us, that there are times that I myself have wondered some of the same things he wondered about. But when doing that, I drew closer to God and he fell further away. Now, have any of you ever had conversations with someone who kind of wonders why you believe what you believe? Why on Sunday mornings you get up and come here? Why you understand God in a different way? That maybe you've been sold, you know what, you're just sheep. You've just been led astray. You're just delusional. Well, when I'm asked why I believe in Jesus Christ, and I actually will say, gosh, you are a very smart and articulate woman. Why would you devote your life to a fairy tale like that? When people ask me, well, where's the proof that God exists, let alone this triune God? Well, I have a lot of answers. But one of them is actually about today. It's about Pentecost Sunday, the birth of the church. This movement that started out as a ragtag, a group of people following another person who claimed he was God and yet human. This has been sustained throughout our history. And despite our human brokenness of greed and our need to attain power and to exploit people, to cast out people, the church is still an active agent in the world, making a difference, creating hope, and bringing groups of all kinds of people under one roof. See, the church is just one way that I know that God is real. Because if there was not something divine driving this broken institution, it would have fallen a long time ago. This fascination with the early church, that's what drove me or flew me to Turkey and Greece last fall, so I could walk in those footsteps of the early church. And in prepping for that trip, I had to do some history work. Now, when you look at the numbers, I know we've got some numbers people and some history people in our group. In 40 CE, so that's around the time that the church began to get organized, there was about 1,000 people in the Roman Empire. Now, I know the book of Acts says that on the day of Pentecost, 3,000 more were added to the number. The writer, he's inflating it a little bit just to make a point. But most historians and scholars think that in the Roman Empire at that time, there was 1,000, which equals less than 0.0017% of the population. Now by 300, and this is before Constantine said that Christianity was the religion, it had grown to over 6 million people in the Roman Empire, which was still only 10% of the population. By 350, so now Constantine had ruled it as part of what the world should be, it was over 56% of the population, 33 million. So I was like, huh, I wonder where Christianity is now in today's world. So according to the World Population Review in 2022, so that's today, Christianity is still the largest religion with 2.38 billion people around the world. What do you think's next? Islam. Islam is next largest with 1.91 billion, and it's projected to catch up to Christianity by 2050. Any idea what the third most popular religion is around the world? Hinduism is third with 1.16 billion. But listen to this, folks. There are currently 1.19 billion people in our world that consider themselves unaffiliated with any religion. our work isn't done yet. This all began on Pentecost Sunday, when the Holy Spirit danced on the heads of the disciples. You know, whether it was 11 of them or 25, or some scholars even say 100 of them, in that moment, the Spirit spoke to the nations in languages that only they could understand. And those disciples, they became apostles. You know what an apostle is? It's someone who's been sent on a mission. That's the difference between disciple and apostle. A disciple is someone who believes. An apostle is someone who believes and is sent. And what was that mission? It was a mission to proclaim the goodness of God, of Jesus. Where Pastor Bruce ended that reading, it said, "In salvation you will know my name," that he came to save people. Jesus brought down the powerful and he lifted up the lowly. He filled the hungry with goodness. He sent the rich away hungry and healed those who suffered. Jesus comforted those who were grieving. He clothed those who were naked, and he brought those who were cast out by society's rules. He brought them into this community, into this family with grace. So a couple of things I want to keep in perspective of the early church. Guess what? They didn't have a leader. Think about that. All of that growth that happened, Jesus, their shepherd, their pastor, had already ascended and left them. The church growth was not about a leader. It was about the people. It was about this unity that prevailed amongst the various churches. Now, we know there was division. Read the book of Revelation. You know there's division. We're human. It's gonna happen, right? We are broken. We will disagree. But the Spirit prevails. See, being church, it's not about a charismatic leader. It's not about someone who's going to make sure we stick to tradition or someone who's going to bring in the hottest and greatest new understandings. You know, in seminary, one of our professors, Nate Frombach, he would say to us, remember, kind of putting us in our place, remember, leaders, you are but a paragraph on a page of a chapter of a very long book of a congregation. St. John's this year is going to be celebrating 120 years. I've been here three. I did the math. That's 2.5% of the history of St. John's. The resiliency of St. John's is due to the Spirit and the faithfulness of you, the people. We had a meeting of the church and the call committee, the council. We got together and we looked at the past 5 years of St. John's. And there's been a lot of change and instability in the staffing and in the society. There were sabbaticals, pastors coming and going. There was sickness among the staff and among the world. St. John's has seen a lot of chaos. But through the power of the Holy Spirit, you have continued to be faithful and to thrive. You know, another thing to think about for the early church, it wasn't about the buildings. Actual churches didn't exist until about 120. So in that first 100 years or so of the church, it was families, communities, meeting in homes, in shops, and it was people living a different way, being called into ministry where they found themselves. Guess what, folks? They didn't need to wear name tags because they actually knew each other. That's why we need to wear name tags. If you don't have it on now, now's your opportunity. They were these groups of people called together to live a different way. See, Christianity wasn't just a belief at that point. It was actually a way of being. Following Christ poured into every part of your life. It was how they practiced their business. It was how they treated the poor, the children, and the society. It was how they treated the hungry and their neighbors and their enemies, the people who persecuted them. Christians didn't seek out vengeance. Instead, they offered forgiveness. They moved out into this world caring for others and seeking unity. St. John's, you are called into ministry. You have flames dancing on your heads. No matter your age, no matter your depth of faith, God is calling you. Christ has a mission for you, and the Spirit is sending you. My friend Pastor Jenny, who preached with me here one time, she has this saying that we are all called to tend different parts of the vineyard. For some pastors, it's to go into the rural churches. For others, it's the inner city, and others, it's suburban. For some, it's for large churches. For some, it's for small churches. That no part of the vineyard is better than the other. We're all just called to tend different parts. Where is the Spirit calling you? Where are you being sent out? It could be to a loved one who is suffering, that it is your calling to care for them, to advocate for them. Or maybe you're being sent to be present to your family, to be available, opening yourself up to loving them and letting them love you. We can be called into our workplaces to proclaim Christ's grace. Whether you are a supervisor or a coworker, how you act in your work world is how you are called to serve. There's no age limit. You are called to serve your friends at school, your pets, or even whoever you encounter in the grocery stores, the doctors. Or perhaps you're being called to a passion of yours, that there's something stirring inside of you. So you go to the Hope Center for Children, you go to the Humane Society, Backpack Buddies, Blood Connection, the Soup Kitchen, the Environment and Creation, or it could be through your church, serving as a committee in hospitality, teaching, and cleaning. Studies have been done that if you write things down, you are more likely, like almost at 42%, more likely to actually do something. So, in your bulletins, you should find two cards that have flames. They look like this. I want you to take a moment, and we're going to do a little exercise. Again, you can use the pens that were in the red books, or grab your own. But I'm going to ask you to write the same thing on both flames. So you don't have to worry about trying to think of two things, two places, two heart spaces. But I'm going to give you about 30 seconds of silence to write down where you are being called and sent by the Spirit. And then you're going to do two things. That's why you have two flames. One of those, you're going to tuck away, you're going to take it home, you're going to put it someplace. That's for you to remember where God is calling you. The other one, when you come up for communion, you see the offering plate in front of the baptism font. If you're coming for communion, you can put it there. If you're not coming up for communion, you can put it over there in the offering box over there. We're going to make a bulletin board. Who doesn't love an old school bulletin board? But to remind us that St. John's has been set on fire for mission, and that this flame is going to spread all over the world through you. So I'm going to time it so you don't have to worry about it. Take 30 seconds. Everyone, again, doesn't matter your age, your stage, just write it down. No answer is too weird. Wherever you feel God is calling you, where the Spirit is sending you. And if you don't know, now's a great time to pray. And again, you can bring those up when we do communion as your offering, or put them in the offering box when you leave. For Pentecost is the birthday of the church. It's where the triune God did a new thing. And St. John's is going to be doing a new thing with the same faithful God. You are what God is creating new. You are who Jesus is calling you into ministry. So be ready to be ablaze and set the world on fire for Christ. Amen.
Please rise as you're able and let us confess our faith together, the faith of the church. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Set free from captivity to sin and death, we pray to God for the resurrection. We pray to the God of resurrection for the church, people in need, and all of creation. Holy living one, holy moving one, burst open our locked doors, and by your Spirit drive us out into the world proclaiming your mighty deeds. Direct our words and actions, trusting the advocate abiding in and among us. Lord, in your mercy, feed and care for creatures that remained hidden to us, yet contribute to the vibrancy of your creation. Train us to interact with creation from a place of wonder, awe, and reverence. Lord, in your mercy, send your Spirit to places where language is a barrier to justice and mercy for those who seek it. Bless the work of translators, interpreters, and teachers. Promote understanding for the sake of those longing for true freedom and peace. And Lord, we do pray for peace, for a just peace, for Ukraine and Syria and Yemen and all places torn by warfare and violence. Lord, in your mercy, comfort all who live in constant fear. And be with all who are suffering. We lift before you today, especially Jackie Maydell, Ann Berger, Sharon Folk, Hervey Thomas, Jane Gant, Ed Maydell, Julia Fuchs, Linda Legman, Stephanie Legman, Elizabeth Roche, Everett Leinberger, Chris Sigman, Jean Spearman, Linda Ebert, Gil Bowman, Tanya Heineman, the grandmother of Grace Geddes, and the family of Susan Clark, and all those whom we name now before you aloud or in our hearts. Remind them that your Spirit has made them your children and that they are never far from your love. Lord, in your mercy, guide all bishops, pastors, missionaries, and other ministers of the gospel. Foster our relationships with partner synods and local ministry partners, that our visions and actions are Spirit-led. Lord, in your mercy, gather your people across regions, nations, and lands, root our common life in the life, death, and resurrection of Christ. And by your Spirit, bind us together with all the saints who have gone before us. Lord, in your mercy. In your mercy, O God, respond to these prayers and renew us by your life-giving Spirit through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. You may be seated. We do have lots going on. I encourage you to read the announcements, but I want to emphasize a few of those for you. Volunteers are needed for the meal packing event. It's going to begin this Friday. There's going to be volunteers needed for setup, and then from 6 to 8, people will be packing meals here. And then next Saturday morning, from 9 to 12, we need 40 to 60 volunteers of all ages to come help package meals for Spartanburg. Frank Rutisol will be around. He's right there, but he'll be around after the service to answer any questions, to take down your names, to do anything else to help prepare for that. And also, I think we're going to be asking people to help start setting up the room here, moving chairs and such after the service today. VBS, June 20th through 24th, will be doing this in conjunction with Joy Lutheran Church. It will be held at their facility. But encourage you, if you have children, grandchildren, nieces, nephews, share with neighbors about it, whatever. A wonderful ministry and a wonderful way to reach out. Today, just a little bit, we will be commissioning our call committee. This is the last mailing, bulk mailing of the visitor. So we want to be good stewards of the resources we've been given in finance and times. Paper copies will be available here at church. It will be available online. You can ask contact the office and say you'd like to have one mailed to you, but we're not going to be mailing them out to everybody starting from now on. And in connection, not really quite connection with that, but anyway, things going on in the office. We do have changes, and this week particularly, our interim parish administrator is not going to be in the office. We've got volunteers in the office some days this week, in the afternoons mostly. But there will be times when there won't be anybody here in the office. So if you need to reach either me or Pastor Aaron for any reason, please call our cell phones. Also, if you want to come and volunteer, help out in the office, that's great. And if you know of anybody you think would make a great full-time parish administrator for us, we're still in the process of looking for that. Those are our primary announcements this morning, and ask Pastor Aaron to come up for the commissioning of the call committee.
Thank you. As today is the birthday of the church, it's also the birthday of this church as it begins to search for its 10th senior pastor. It's a time of reflection and prayer, a time for self-examination, a time of expectation and hope. We need a shepherd to lead our flock, and God has promised that one will be provided for us. So just as in Jerusalem, 50 days after the ascension, Jesus had flames danced on the apostles' heads and were sent into ministry, we have those flames. Just so you know, this is the sermon recap. We have those flames. And today we are blessed as 6 people in our congregation are dancing into the call committee through those. So we have 3 who are here with us this morning. Let me ask Dana Holman, Roxanne Rush, and Dr. Nan Dempsey to please come forward and join me up here. Joining them on the call committee is Doug Kurz, Dr. David Holt, and Stephanie Huchek as well. Come and join me up here, right on up. Dear friends, you've been duly appointed to serve as the call committee for St. John's Lutheran Church in order to seek a pastor, a shepherd, to lead us. You have been given a position of trust in this congregation. It will be your duty in consultation with the bishop's office to seek out appropriate candidates for the position of senior pastor, a pastor who strives for righteousness and godliness. faith and love, endurance and gentleness. A pastor who is a servant as Christ himself was a servant, who leads with care and concern for God's flock. A pastor who is filled with the Holy Spirit and trustworthy steward of the mysteries of God. You must be faithful in your efforts, always respecting the concerns of the congregation, while at the same time maintaining the integrity of the process. Above all else, you must be diligent in prayer, so that God's will is done and is God who is glorified by your efforts. On behalf of your brothers and sisters in Christ, I ask you, are you ready to accept and faithfully carry out the duties of this appointment? If so, say yes with the help of God.
Yes, with the help of God.
Yours is a spiritual endeavor on behalf of this congregation. Are you willing, therefore, to be open to the Spirit's leading and by prayer and holy conversation to undertake this calling to seek a shepherd for us? If so, say yes with the help of God.
Yes, with the help of God.
Will you be diligent in your seeking, careful in your listening, purposeful in your questioning, and respectful in all that you do? I don't know if I need to repeat that. You got one more. Will you seek the Lord's guidance through holy scriptures and prayer and in your deliberations with your fellow committee members until you are brought to one mind and one will in Christ and have chosen a good shepherd for us? If so, say yes with the help of God.
Yes, with the help of God.
People of God, I ask you, will you support these members of the call committee? Will you remember them in your prayers and respect their responsibilities and honor their efforts? If so, say yes with the help of God.
Yes.
We pray. Almighty God, you alone are the great shepherd of the sheep, and we turn to you to lead and to guide us in all things. Our trust and our hope is in you. Send us a shepherd of goodness and grace, of strength and faith, of righteousness in your sight. Send us a pastor to comfort and care for us, to preach your word, to teach our children, to baptize and commune, to marry and counsel, to visit the sick and to lay to the rest, to guide us, to lead us, and to keep St. John centered in you and moving out into the world. Give us a holy patience in this time of our seeking, a patience that trusts in you for our present care, knowing that you will bring our good work to fulfillment in your time. Keep us faithful in mission, regular in worship, responsible in stewardship, mindful of the needy, and diligent in prayer. And bless those who are especially called to serve on the call committee. Give them the gifts they need to seek and find the pastor of your own nurturing, the shepherd of your own choosing, that we might be fed by your holy word and sacraments and grow in faith and love and ministry. All these things we ask, O God, with whatever else we need, in the name of him who is the good shepherd, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I now declare that you have been installed and commissioned as the call committee of St. John's Lutheran Church. May God bring your good work to fulfillment and grace in Christ's name. Amen. You may return to your seats. And we did this before communion because it reminds us that even though we are all part of various missions and are all doing various ministries, we are all coming together as one on equal footing in this beautiful sacred table where Jesus is the host. I turn it back to you, Pastor Bruce.
Christ comes to us bringing us his body and blood as we receive the bread and the cup. Reminder that in Holy Communion, we celebrate it three ways here at St. John's at this time. For those at home, reminder, prepare your home altar. For those who have the individual communion kits, prepare those now, prepare to receive that. The other opportunity will be to come forward and receive communion by intention in just a minute. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." The body of Christ given for you. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." The blood of Christ shed for you. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The wine has been poured, the bread has been broken. All are welcome at God's table.
Jesus,
Please rise. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Let us pray. We give you thanks, generous God, for in this bread and cup we have tasted the new heaven and earth, where hunger and thirst are no more. Send us from this table as witnesses to the resurrection, that through our lives all may know life in Jesus' name. Amen. May the Spirit of the living Christ fill you with faith and trust, burn in you with the fire of love, enliven your bones, body, and life, and breathe through you the breath of life. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Our
Before you are dismissed, don't forget to stack chairs. Go in peace to be the church and in the world. Thanks be to God. And stack chairs.
And stack chairs.